Letter 16, A Thing to be Forgotten. I want to say a word to those who are about to die. I want to beg them to forget their bodies as soon as possible, after the change which they call death. Oh, the terrible curiosity to go back and look upon that thing which we once believed to be ourselves. The thought comes to us now and then so powerfully that it acts in a way against our will and draws us back to it. With some, it is a morbid obsession, and many cannot get free from it while there remains a shred of flesh on the bones which they once leaned upon. Tell them to forget it altogether, to force the thought away, to go out into the other life free. Looking back upon the past is sometimes good, but not upon this relic of the past. It is so easy to look into the coffin, because the body which we wear now is itself a light in a dark place, and it can penetrate grosser matter. I have been back myself a few times, but am determined to go back no more. Yet some day, the thought may come to me again with compelling insistence to see how it is getting on. I do not want to shock or pain you, only to warn you. It is sad to see the sight which inevitably meets one in the grave. That may be the reason why many souls who have not been here long are so melancholy. They return again and again to the place which they should not visit. You know that out here, if we think intently of a place, we are apt to find ourselves there. The body which we use is so light that it can follow thought almost without effort. Tell them not to do it. One day, while walking down an avenue of trees, for we have trees here, I met a tall woman in a long black garment. She was weeping, for we have tears here also. I asked her why she wept, and she turned to me, eyes of unutterable sadness.
I have been back to it,
she said. My heart ached for her, because I knew how she felt. The shock of the first visit is repeated each time, as the thing one sees is less and less what we like to think of ourselves as being. Often I remember that tall woman in black, walking down the avenue of trees and weeping. It is partly curiosity that draws one back, partly magnetic attraction, but it can do no good. It is better to forget it. I have sometimes longed, from sheer scientific interest, to ask my boy Lionel if he had been back to his body, but I have not asked him for fear of putting the idea into his mind. He has such a restless curiosity. Perhaps those who go out as children have less of that morbid instinct than we have. If we could only remember in life that the form which we call ourselves is not our real immortal self at all, we would not give it such an exaggerated importance, though we would nevertheless take needful care of it. As a rule, those who say that they have been long here do not seem old. I asked the teacher why, and he said that after a time an old person forgets that he is old, that the tendency is to grow young in thought, and therefore young in appearance, that the body tends to take the form which we hold of it in our minds, that the law of rhythm works here as elsewhere. Children grow up out here, and they may even go on to a sort of old age if that is the expectation of the mind, but the tendency is to keep the prime, to go forward or back towards the best period, and then to hold that until the irresistible attraction of the earth asserts itself again. Most of the men and women here do not know that they have lived many times in flesh. They remember their latest life more or less vividly, but all before that seems like a dream. One should always keep the memory of the past as clear as possible. It helps one to construct the future. Those people who think of their departed friends as being all wise, how disappointed they would be if they could know that the life on this side is only an extension of the life on earth. If the thoughts and desires there have been only for material pleasures, the thoughts and desires here are likely to be the same. I have met veritable saints since coming out, but they have been men and women who held in earth life the saintly ideal and who now are free to live it. Life can be so free here. There is none of that machinery of living which makes people on earth such slaves. In our world, a man is held only by his thoughts. If they are free, he is free. Few, though, are of my philosophic spirit. There are more saints here than philosophers, as the highest ideal of most persons, when intensely active, has been towards the religious rather than the philosophic life. I think the happiest people I have met on this side have been the painters. Our matter is so light and subtle, and so easily handled that it falls readily into the forms of the imagination. There are beautiful pictures here. Some of our artists try to impress their pictures upon the mental eyes of the artists of Earth, and they often succeed in doing so. There is joy in the heart of one of our real artists when a fellow craftsman on your side catches an idea from him and puts it into execution. He may not always be able to see clearly how well the second man works out the idea, for it requires a special gift or a special training to see from one form of matter into the other, but the inspiring spirit catches the thought in the inspired one's mind, and knows that a conception of his own is being executed upon the earth. With poets, it is the same. There are lovely lyrics composed out here and impressed upon the receptive minds of earthly poets. A poet told me that it was easier to do that with a short lyric than with an epic or a drama, where a long continued effort was necessary. It is much the same with musicians. Whenever you go to a concert where beautiful music is being played, there is probably all around you a crowd of music-loving spirits, drinking in the harmonies. Music on earth is much enjoyed on this side. It can be heard. But no sensitive spirit likes to go near a place where bad strumming is going on. We prefer the music of stringed instruments. Of all earthly things, sound reaches most directly into this plane of life. Tell that to the musicians. If they could only hear our music. I did not understand music on earth, but now my ears are becoming adjusted. It seems sometimes as if you must hear our music over there as we hear yours. You may have wondered how I spend my time and where I go. There is a lovely spot in the country which I never tire of visiting. It is on the side of a mountain, not far from my own city. There is a little road winding around a hill, and just above the road is a hut, a roofed enclosure with the lower side open. Sometimes I stay there for hours and listen to the rippling of the brook which runs beside the road. The tall, slender trees have become like brothers to me. At first I cannot see the material trees very clearly, but I go into the little hut which is made of fresh clean boards with a sweet smell, and I lie down on the shelf or bunk along the wall. Then I close my eyes and by an effort, or no, it is not what I would call an effort, but by a sort of drifting, I can see the beautiful place. But you must know that this is in the nighttime there, and I see it by the light of myself. That is why we travel in the dark part of the 24 hours, for in the bright sunlight we cannot see at all. Our light is put out by the cruder light of the sun. One night I took the boy Lionel there with me, leaving him in the hut while I went a little distance away. Looking back, I saw the whole hut illuminated by a lovely radiance, the radiance of Lionel himself. The little building, which has a peaked roof, looked like a pearl lighted from within. It was a beautiful experience. I then went to Lionel and told him to go in his turn a little distance away while I took his place in the hut. I was curious to know if he would see the same phenomenon when I lay there, if I could shed such a light through dense matter, the boards of the building. When I called him to me afterwards and asked if he had seen anything strange, he said,
"Wow, a wonderful man you are, Father. How did you make that hut seem to be on fire?"
Then I knew that he had seen the same thing I had seen. But I am tired now and can write no more. Good night, and may you have pleasant dreams. Letter 17, The Second Wife Over There. I am often called upon here to decide matters for others. Many people call me simply the judge, but we bear, as a rule, the name that we last bore on earth. Men and women come to me to settle all sorts of questions for them, questions of ethics, questions of expediency, even quarrels. Did you suppose that no one quarreled here? Many do. There are even long-standing feuds among them. The holders of different opinions on religion are often hot in their arguments. Coming here with the same beliefs they had on earth, and being able to visualize their ideals and actually to experience the things they are expecting, two men who hold opposite creeds forcibly are each more intolerant than ever before. Each is certain that he is right, and that the other is wrong. This stubbornness of belief is strongest with those who have been here only a short time. After a while, they fall into a larger tolerance, living their own lives more and more, and enjoying the world of proofs and realizations which each soul builds for itself. but I want to give you an illustration of the sort of questions on which I am asked to pass judgment. There are two women here who in life were both married to one man, though not at the same time. The first woman died, then the man married again, and soon, not more than a year or two after, the man and his second wife both came out. The first wife considers herself the man's only wife, and she follows him about everywhere. She says that he promised to meet her in heaven. He is more inclined to the second wife, though he still feels affection for wife number one. He is rather impatient at what he calls her unreasonableness. He told me one day that he would gladly give them both up if he could be left in peace to carry out certain studies in which he is interested. These were among the people I met soon after I began to be strong myself here. It was not so very long ago, and the man has sought my society so much that the women, in order to be near him, have come along too. One day they all three came to me and propounded their question, or rather, wife number one propounded it. She said,
"This man is my husband. Should not, therefore, this other woman go far away and leave him altogether to me?"
I asked wife number two what she had to say. Her answer was that she would be all alone here, but for her husband, and that as she had had him last, he now belonged more to her than to the other. In a flash, the memory came to me of those Sadducees who propounded a similar question to Christ, and I quoted his answer as nearly as I could remember it, that when they shall rise from the dead, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are as the angels which are in heaven. My answer was as much a staggerer for them as their question had been for me, and they went away to think about it. When they were gone, I began myself to ponder the question. I had already observed that, whether or not all here are as the angels in heaven, there does seem to be a good deal of mating and rejoining of former mates. The sex distinction is as real here as on the earth, though of course its expression is not exactly the same. I asked myself a good many questions which perhaps would never have occurred to me, but for the troubles of this interesting triad, and I thought of the man I had somewhere read about, who said that he never knew his own opinion of anything until he tried to express it to somebody. After a while, the three came to me again and said that they had been talking things over, perhaps after the manner of angels in heaven, for wife number one told me that she had decided to let her husband spend a part of his time with the other woman if he wanted to. Now, the man had a sweetheart, a girl sweetheart, before he had either of his wives. The girl is out here somewhere, and the man often has a strong desire to try to find her. What opportunity he will now have to do so, I cannot say. The situation is rather depressing for the poor fellow. It is bad enough to have one person who insists on every minute of your society without having two. And I think his case is not unusual. Perhaps the only way in which he can get free from his two insistent companions is by going back to the earth. There is a way, however, by which he could secure solitude, but he does not know of it. A man who knows how can isolate himself here as well as he could on earth. He can build round himself a wall which only the eyes of a great initiate can pierce. I have not told this secret to my friend, but perhaps I shall some day, if it seems necessary for his development, that he have a little solitude. At present, it seems to me that he will learn more from adjusting to this double claim and trying to find the truth that lies in it. Perhaps he may learn that, really, essentially, fundamentally, he does not belong to either of these women. The souls out here seem to belong to themselves, and after the first few years they get to love liberty so much that they are ready to yield a little of their claim upon others. This is a great place in which to grow, if one really wants to grow, though few persons take advantage of its possibilities. Most are content to assimilate the experiences they had on earth. It would be depressing to one who did not realize that will is free, to see how souls let slip their opportunities here, even as they did on the moon-guarded planet. There are teachers here who stand ready to help anyone who wishes their help in making real and deep studies in the mysteries of life. The life here, the life there, and in the remote past. If a man understands that his recent sojourn on earth was merely the latest of a long series of lives, and if he concentrates his mind towards recovering the memories of the distant past, he can recover them. Some persons may think that the mere dropping of the veil of matter should free the soul from all obscuration, but as on earth so out here, things are not thus and so because they ought to be, but because they are. We draw to ourselves the experiences which we are ready for, and which we demand, and most souls do not demand enough here, any more than they did in life. Tell them to demand more, and the demand will be answered.